It's a little daunting to talk about my life 45 years ago. And it becomes a little more difficult every year. Not only the years mount, but the ability to remember decreases. I'd like to comment first on a couple of the remarks by the dean and about Dean Brandis and when Chambers came here to go to law school. What is often not mentioned is that Chambers, after being first in his class at this tiny high school in Mount Gilead, and then first in his class at North Carolina Central College, and then went to University of Michigan, where he got a master's in history, I think, and then decided he was going to go to law school. He applied here, and he was admitted on probation. This was a student who became first in his class, I think, from the minute he came in the building, and it wasn't this building. And his experience here, although it's properly celebrated by this law school that he was one of theirs, it was not a happy time for him and his family. Chapel Hill was not welcoming to young African Americans. He was recently married, and he and his wonderful wife were here, and she talks about how wonderful it was when they could leave Chapel Hill. One incident is that when he was on Law Review in those days, the Law Review would have an annual meeting, dinner, and it was at the Chapel Hill Country Club, which was then just down the road here. I think it's a tennis complex now. And he was invited not to attend because the Chapel Hill Country Club was not interested in having guests of color. So there was that, and the dean mentioned meeting with him, and he was very quiet spoken, but I think, and everybody, and he did mumble. I mean, he was a mumbler, and I heard him in court mumbling. But there was something about the core of the man that was just so powerful. No matter, if you read the transcripts of his oral arguments in the Supreme Court, you say, well, you know, that's good. He answered the questions well. Obviously, he's well prepared. He knows the law. But what you don't get there is the power that was coming from the man. So this was a guy went off. Then went to Columbia and got a master's in law, and was persuaded to go to the Legal Defense Fund and be one of the first Legal Defense Fund interns, who was then going to be placed back home to do battle for civil rights. And he ended up after a year in Charlotte. And I first met him in the summer of 65, which is when the Swan case was first tried. And the context there is that the Civil Rights Act had been passed the year before that, which had a provision which allowed the federal government to withhold funds if there was segregation going on in a facility that was getting federal funds. And that started making some difference. That was pressure that ultimately was very important in desegregation across the South. And Chambers, before I got there in the summer of 65, had already filed the Swan case. And there was a trial scheduled that summer. And I got to participate with at least as a visitor as he was getting ready for that hearing and for the hearing, and I think it was probably just a couple of days, a couple of things I remember is Derek Bell, who was then at Legal Defense Fund and who later became a law professor here and there, dean at Oregon, at Harvard, and he was kind of the main civil rights lawyer I know of who was involved in pushing for school desegregation, who changed his mind, and he did not think that that was what was that was the way to go to improve lives for African Americans. But Chambers and Derek Bell remained good friends for the rest of Derek Bell's life. In fact, Chambers named his son Derek. There was a meeting the night before the hearing, and in the meeting was a member of the school board. Now, the school board, of course, was the defendant in the case, and I think that most plaintiff's lawyers would not entertain that interaction. That you're not supposed to be talking to the other side's clients without knowledge, at least, or permission, at least, of the other side's counsel. There was a lot of that sort of thing. Kind of things were looser then, and certainly in that case, there was plenty of ex-party conversation with the judge by lawyers on both sides. Judge McMillan reached out to members of the school board, other people in the community, and it was really interesting. The first trial we had, Judge Brack Craven was the district court judge then, and after the trial he entered a decision in saying, which was then the mantra, that Brown didn't require integration, it just required desegregation. If it was colorblind in some sense, that was good enough. And while the school board had come in and said, we are beginning to integrate our faculties and doing some with our transportation, and this is our plan going forward, and Judge Craven said, well, that sounded pretty good. And we appealed, and the case sat in the Fourth Circuit for some time, and during the course of that time, and finally the Fourth Circuit said, affirmed Judge Craven's order, partly on the basis of newspaper stories, saying that in fact they had done some more integration of faculties and transportation, that they had created geographic zones for the schools, and they had a freedom of choice transfer policy. I'm not sure whether it was majority to minority, which, or whether it was simply you could transfer out. But in any event, they found that all fine. And the case sat there, and we were continuing. I think we had 50 school desegregation cases pending in the state. And then sort of kind of out of the blue in 1968, the Supreme Court decided a case called Green against New Kent County from Virginia. And New Kent County was a rural school system with two schools. And one was a black school and one was a white school. They didn't need geographic zones because you knew where you were to go. You could just look at the color of your skin, and that was your assignment. The case was litigated, and the plaintiffs said that isn't going to cut it. A freedom of choice plan in these circumstances will not desegregate the schools. And the United States Supreme Court said, you're right. What Brown requires is the elimination of having white schools and black schools. We need to have just schools. We need to eliminate race, root and branch from the system. And in New Kent County, that would mean if you drew a line just across the county, you'd have integrated schools on both sides, two schools. And I recall, then in 1968, by then I'm working for Chambers, we had a meeting, said, well, they decided this. We knew that we were certainly going to use the Green case in a lot of our school desegregation cases. And we talked about Charlotte, and we said, well, what did it mean to have this two-school model? How did that apply to Charlotte, where there were, I think, 106 schools? Then there were 25 schools that were all black or nearly all black. There were 57 schools that were all white, or maybe a handful or so of black kids attending. How did that all apply here? And there was nowhere to draw a line across Mecklenburg County to create integration the way it could be done in New Kent County. And so we proceeded. We started doing discovery and gathering experts and figuring out what we were going to do, and decided that what we really needed to do was to persuade the judge that the full desegregation, whatever that meant, of Charlotte-Mecklenburg was important, not only because the Supreme Court said so, but we wanted to prove that the Supreme Court in Brown was correct. And so we put before the court all the test scores, which apparently for the Pearsall Commission or people then, the achievement gaps were shown as justifying keeping the schools separate. We were putting them forward, showing that what the segregated schools were doing, that they it was injuring the black kids who were behind. We also proved that all the facilities were second rate, the black schools were, despite the we had separate but unequal, and we spent a lot of time on that, and we came in with education experts and had put on, I can't remember how many different hearings we had, but Judge McMillan kind of sucked up all the information. He just wanted more and more. And I remember once being in his chambers on another matter, and we got done with that, and he said, Adam, what is it you folks want in this Charlotte case? And I had no idea what our ultimate goal was, and sort of more. And McMillan laughed. And one thing about the election in Charlotte that got him elected judge, one thing he had going for him was that he was just kind of a wonderful, warm person. Had a great smile, and really smart, a great lawyer, and so he had that to begin with, in addition to the fact that he hadn't desegregated the parks. And I remember, well, when I first went to work for Chambers, his nomination was pending before the Senate, meeting him, I think, at a calendar call or motion hearing or something in federal court with Chambers, and Chambers introduced me to him, and he said, this is the guy who's going to replace Judge Craven. And so I asked about him, and he said, no, he'll be great. Chambers had served on the legal services board with him, which was all a brand new idea, Parmy law, and he said, no, he'll be really good, although he had expressed openly that he didn't think busing was a good idea, but he was somebody who was who Chambers just knew by knowing him that this was a good person, and by the time we were done with all the hearings we had, there was nobody in Charlotte who understood better, kind of all the facts that that were relevant to the case. He knew the geography of Mecklenburg County and where all the schools were, 107 schools. That's a hard number to keep track of. He had a sense of all the statistics, and he was really interested in those test scores. And he was also interested, he came to believe that this segregated system was bad for black kids. And so he took off, and it was fairly quick that he entered an order saying, we've got a segregated school system. He didn't describe exactly how far that would take them, but he asked, he ordered the school board to come in with a plan, and the school board came in with a plan, and he said, that isn't any good. And that kept going on. I think the school board was required to come in with about three plans. He finally employed John Finger to create the Finger Plan, which you can imagine showed up on signs and opponents of school desegregation in Charlotte. Finger had been an expert for the plaintiffs, and McMillan had been impressed by his testimony. And ultimately, he entered, he pushed, and the school board finally came in with a plan that desegregated the high schools, I think 9 out of the 10, by having a feeder plan. It desegregated junior high schools pretty much. And for elementary schools, they just did some drawing, gerrymandering some lines, but produced very little desegregation. And Judge McMillan said, that's not good enough. And he ended up ordering the Finger Plan, and immediately that was appealed by the school board. What I remember, and that was going on, and he was requiring that plan go into effect for the next school year, and the school board is saying, we can't do it, we can't get enough buses, we can't do this, and McMillan simply was not persuaded, and he was very friendly and tough. I was the resident expert on school buses in North Carolina. I knew where you could get them and how many the board had and how many miles the present system was sending kids around. We had a large percentage of the Mecklenburg school children rode school buses, and basic part of our argument was you just got to send the buses in different places and pick up different kids and send them to different schools. And we were short a few buses, and kind of just using the present fleet, and I knew where you could get some new ones. And I so when the school system said we can't do it, McMillan didn't believe that. So we had this case pending, and what they did for elementary school, the Finger Plan, paired black schools in the inner city with white suburban schools, elementary schools, where the black kids would be bused out for first and second or first through third grades to the white schools, and the white kids would be bused back for fifth and sixth grade. And it was, and in some places there would be non-contiguous zones that were created. So it was very, it was surprising that somebody would say this would be the way we should organize our schools, and we fought to keep it. They appealed, and they sought a stay from Judge McMillan. He denied the stay. They sought a stay from the Fourth Circuit. And I remember there was also a companion case attacking what was then an anti-busing statute that had been passed by the General Assembly. And in those days, state statutes that were attacked as unconstitutional were heard by a three-judge district court. So we had a hearing before a three-judge district court. I know McMillan was one of the judges. Judge Craven from the Fourth Circuit was one of them. I don't remember who the third was, but what I remember clearly about that day was, the first thing was we found out that the Fourth Circuit granted the stay that day, and which was kind of a big blow. It also was a blow to McMillan, who was taking incredible heat. By then, I think he had marshals guarding his house. He was under threat. His country club friends were kind of moving away from him. You could start seeing twitches in his face. And that happened that day. And then we were getting ready to leave the courthouse, and we got word from the clerk that Judge Craven wanted to meet with plaintiff's lawyers, which was not kind of protocol, but there we were. And we got marched in. We were there, Chambers and me, and maybe somebody else from our firm. Jim Neighbor was a lawyer with the Legal Defense Fund who was worked on a lot of the North Carolina cases with us. And we had attacked this statute, and that had been argued, and we said it was unconstitutional. Craven didn't want to talk about that statute. He wanted to tell us that his court, meaning the Fourth Circuit, would not approve of what Judge McMillan had done. He wouldn't be sitting because he had previously been a district court judge on the case, but he was telling us what his court would do. That was also pretty discouraging. So we had a bad day kind of both ways, and then the case went forward in the Fourth Circuit. And finally, the Fourth Circuit decided the case. It affirmed what Judge McMillan had done and ordered with regard to the high schools and junior high schools, but had said, we really don't know what's going on down there with elementary school. This all looks pretty severe, and sent it back for further consideration of that. And so we filed in the United States Supreme Court, thought to stay the decision of the Fourth Circuit. Supreme Court denied that, and then we filed a cert petition asking for review of the Fourth Circuit's order. We also asked that the court come back early for the October term that was coming up, and we asked that the court at that point enter an order putting it back into effect, Judge McMillan's order requiring all this full desegregation at the beginning of the term. And the Supreme Court did that. It granted cert and said this stay that the Court of Appeals had granted was lifted, and North Carolina in Charlotte was required to go ahead with this desegregation. A couple kind of war stories about going through that. This was during the Nixon administration. President Nixon was railing against the Judge McMillan's orders. And his Solicitor General was Irwin Griswold, who had been dean of the Harvard Law School. And we had a meeting with Griswold before the arguments to talk about the case. And I went there with Chambers and Jack Greenberg. And I guess our mission was to persuade Griswold to be on our side, to say that what Judge McMillan had done was correct and it should not be disturbed. And I recall, mainly what I recall is saying, gee, I'm 2 years out of law school, I'm meeting with the Solicitor General. And he was very polite and friendly and so on. And when he did argue, he said, well, this is going too fast, what McMillan has done. really shouldn't affirm that. You should, the Fourth Circuit's got it right. It should, what's going on with the elementary schools are sufficient. So that's kind of where we were. The case came back to Charlotte, and I think Luke is going to talk to us later today about subsequent events in Charlotte after his decision. But one thing that that was really incredible was that McMillan, right from the beginning, kept entering orders saying, bring me another plan, bring me another plan. And at one point, a group of citizens, not school board members, got together and started trying to work up a plan, including some mothers, and McMillan embraced that, and he kind of sort of sanctioned their efforts. And this is post-Supreme Court, when they're still talking about, because the plan that had been appealed was an interim plan. And so ultimately, he entered an order of a plan that was kind of grew out of the community of people who wanted to find a way to make it work. And McMillan was very successful in getting Charlotte on board, because for years, and we'll find out about kind of when it came undone, but we had, I think, nearly two decades where a school board was being elected and re-elected, and the assignment plans that were in effect were always front and center, and the school board members who were saying, what McMillan got us to do has made Charlotte better, they kept winning. So I think that's what I got.